NIN are expected to initiate people-centric activities in order to educate the masses on various nutritional themes impacting people's lives. Several media channels and scientific platforms are utilized during this month for IEC. All over the country, and systematic efforts are made to inform and educate people on nutritional issues so as to enhance the quality of their lives. Now, this year, we are celebrating the Poshan Maah with the theme entitled Converging Towards a Healthy Walk Through Life. This is the title. In this theme, please note, the word convergence has a wider meaning. It clearly indicates that making our nation walk through a healthy life is possible only with collective effort. Keeping this in view, we have organized today's webinar with the title Nutrient Requirement, Implications of Timing and Policy. And policy, our director is going to enlighten us, and timing, Dr. Lakshmaya Garu is going to enlighten us. And to reach the goal of achieving complete health, all possible efforts should be made both at the individual level as well as at the governmental levels to promote the nutritional well-being of the people. They need to be educated on adopting better nutritional practices, and governmental agencies need to be helped in initiating appropriate nutritional interventions. Through right community nutrition strategies, including tailor-made extension and behavior change communication methods, we have to transform people's lifestyles. This National Nutrition Month provides us all a good opportunity to engage in a dialogue with people on everyday nutrition. The questions pertaining to quality and quantity of diet, food taboos, food safety, and double and triple burden of malnutrition have to be addressed on priority basis. Hence, even face-to-face interactions with population groups are of the utmost importance. All these efforts, if carried out properly, will lead to the emergence of a healthy nation. In order to enlighten us on some of the highly relevant themes of the present-day nutrition world, we have two eminent scientists from our institute who will be speaking to us in this webinar. Dr. R. Hemalatha Garu, director of our institute, will be speaking on the topic policy implications, the nutrient requirements for Indians, RDA and EAR, followed by Dr. A. Lakshmaya, scientist G and HOD, Public Health Division, who will be talking to us on the topic feeding smart, right from start, relevance and reality. I am aware that you are all very eager to listen to the two speakers now. Once again, I welcome you all. And now I request Dr. Uma Chitra to be the moderator of today's webinar. Thank you one and all. Dr. Uma Chitra.
Yes, thank you so much, Dr. Maheshwar, sir, for the welcome address. And before I introduce our respected director, Dr. R. Hemalatha, I request everyone, if you have any questions, kindly post them in the chat box and we'll get back to you at the end of the session. As sir has already spoken about the topic which our director is going to speak about, I'll straight away go to the introduction. I have the honor today of introducing the director of ICMR, National Institute of Nutrition, Dr. R. Hemalatha. Dr. Hemalatha's research interests encompass areas like maternal child health and nutrition, immunology, and public health nutrition. She has authored more than 200 peer-reviewed scientific papers, book chapters, and regulatory reports. She spearheaded the dietary recommendation, My Plate for the Day, which provides food-based guidelines for meeting micro and macronutrient requirements for healthy individuals. She also led the seminal work on nutrient requirements for Indians, the book comprising the revised RDAs and EARs for Indians. Nutrition and health e-modules developed for general public under her leadership are being widely used across the country. The report, What India Eats, highlights the lacunae of average urban and rural Indians and has policy implications. Dr. Hemalatha is also serving as the president of the Nutrition Society of India and executive council member of the Federation of Asian Nutrition Societies. Additionally, she holds positions as expert member of various task force committees of the Ministry of Women and Child Development, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, Codex India, Bureau of Indian Standards, National Council of Nutrition, Niti Aayog, and Interministerial Central Team for COVID, etc. Our director, ma'am, graduated and obtained MD from Gandhi Medical College, Hyderabad, Dr. NTR University of Health Sciences. She is a fellow of the International Union of Nutrition Sciences, fellow of National Academy of Medical Sciences, and fellow of Telangana Academy of Sciences. She has been honored with awards such as Ponduru Venkat Ramana Rao Gold Medal, 7th Dr. Rajamal P. Devadas Memorial Oration Award, Dr. Kamla Puri Sabarwal Memorial Award, Change Maker Award, and Professor M. Vishwanathan Gold Medal Oration Award. After taking over as director of ICMR NIN, the Institute received the prestigious award for excellence in nutrition science and technology, the Portion Outlook Award. I now request Dr. Hemlata to make her presentation on policy implications, the nutrient requirements for Indians, RDA and EAR. Ma'am, I request
Thank you, Dr. Maheshwar. Thank you, Dr. Uma, for that very flowery words and kind introduction. Now, let me share my screen. What I'll do is, all of you can hear me.
Yes, madam. Yes.
Yes. See, what I'll do is, although I have made presentations on recommended dietary allowances and nutrient requirements, I'll use 5 slides to reiterate the same points, like about the process of development of EAR and RDA. Just 4 to 5 slides. I mean, this is important to understand because the following slides will be regarding how we arrive at nutrient adequacy, how we calculate the nutrient gap, and what are the strategies that are used for fortification and also food labeling to some extent. So these are the things we'll be running through. Okay. So any one has any doubts anywhere, they can stop me in between. So here's very briefly, I'll be telling about vitamins and minerals and the story behind it. Just in 2 slides, I'll be telling. So we came to know about vitamins and minerals, that they are vitamins, they are vital for life. And only during the 18th century, when many millions of sailors died during long voyages because of scurvy, I mean, whenever they took up long voyages, they knew that they are going to be afflicted with a severe condition where their gums would rot, their skin would develop sores, and then that will be finally leading to death in a few days' time. So this, and James Lind was a young medico who was on the board. I mean, he knew already about scurvy, and that was the first clinical trial that was conducted, and they found success in giving lemon juice and other lemon juice and lime juice when sailors were, I mean, only two sailors were there in each group. He divided them into 6 groups, and this is the first clinical trial ever where they showed that giving lime juice to sailors saved them from this dreadful disease called scurvy. Then many developments happened, like Takaki and beriberi. And it was Jickman who published causes of beriberi when he conducted a series of experiments in chickens. And then finally, in 1912, Funk defines vitamins as vital nutrients. And coming to NIN, the founder director, Sir Robert McCarrison, most of you know, but for young people, this will be some good information, I thought. So he also worked on beriberi because in Andhra Pradesh regions where they ate polished rice, many people were down with neuritis. Then he conducted similar kind of experiments, like while the other scientists earlier conducted on chickens, he conducted the same experiments on birds. When white polished rice was given, the chicks came down with head retraction and polyneuritis. So he concluded that polished rice is depleted of something, and because of that, people develop beriberi. So similarly, NIN has credit of this burning feet syndrome and its association with anthocyanic acid, B vitamin, and then bladder stone and intake of milk and fresh vegetables. I mean, people who were consuming lots of milk and milk products and fresh vegetables were not getting bladder stones, whether a segment of population from poor communities who were not getting this kind of variety diet were developing more frequently bladder stones. Then came story of rickets, scurvy, goiter, beriberi, etc. Now, with all this information, the strong need was felt globally that nutrient composition of food should be there to have information. And then once that is there in place, then how about recommendation? So nutrient composition evaluation of various micro and macronutrients happened in India in 1937, and recommendations on various macro and micronutrients, that is this site, actually was evolved in 1944. From there, series of evaluations happened and series of recommendations and books were released, and the final one about Indian food composition and table that was released in 2017, which consists of 160 different micro and macronutrients, including macronutrients, in 560 foods odd. Then came in 2020, we released this nutrient requirements for Indians, which consists for the first time in India, not only recommended dietary allowance, but also estimated average requirement. So now, globally, what happened is, up till 1994, only recommended dietary allowance was the one only metric that was used. In 1994, Institute of Medicine, US, felt that we need to have more metrics for proper evaluation in individuals and population. So they evolved a comprehensive recommendation consisting of dietary reference intakes, which includes estimated average requirements, then apart from RDA, then adequate intakes and tolerable upper limits. So these values have lots of policy implications. They are used in supplementation programs, fortification strategies, food labeling. So unless until we understand these things, it is difficult for us to be come up to a conclusion with respect to fortification strategies and how do we advise the regulatory bodies and the industries about food labeling and also fortification. So it's important to understand these aspects. Then individual and population requirements we calculate using these two books that were released. Then fixing minimum wages of workers, the government fixes minimum wages of workers based on the calorie requirement that is needed per day, then planning of food production through agriculture, planning the gap that is existing between the production and the requirement, then they plan import of foods to meet the gap in the food needs of the population. So various policy implications are there with these this thing. Now, very briefly, I'll tell you about how to arrive at estimated average requirement. This is a factorial approach. It's called estimated because we use in certain things, we use functional markers, like for example, enzyme activity, then or other functions like sleep or awake and the energy requirement. Then nutrient balance studies, what about the input and output? You take certain amount of protein, calcium, magnesium or zinc and how much is being excreted through urine, sweat and various other outputs. So input and output calculation, which is called nutrient balance. Then turnover studies using stable isotope studies. In this current recommendation, we have iron and B12 labeled with the stable isotopes, and the studies results of that those studies were included. Then obligatory loss, like you give less and less and less protein and see what is the obligatory requirement and obligatory loss with protein. So these are some of the studies that are used to come to a conclusion or come to arrive at the estimated average requirement. Then vitamins and minerals, zinc, magnesium, B6, like depletion, repletion. You deplete it and then again replete it to see the optimal functions of certain parameters. And for example, vitamin C, saturation is also used. For example, you take vitamin C, they keep on giving and see at what level of intake of vitamin C, saturation of RBC takes place. At that level, they say more than this, it is not required. So that way, we arrive at the estimated average requirement. And once this is in place, say for example, this is the estimated average requirement. Don't get overwhelmed. I'll make it in very simple language. Say, for instance, iron requirement. When we estimated the iron requirement based on the intake and the losses, the levels were 11 milligrams for men. Look.
Ma'am, we are not able to hear you.
Dr. Uma.
Sir.
Power failure happened in our office.
Right.
Okay, she will go there. But...
Shall I call Rahul, sir? So I think ma'am will be joining back. Because I...
Maheshwar, you are the host. So you have to see and admit whoever is joining.
Yes.
On your side, you have been converted the host actually.
So that was not communicated to me, Subbarao.
No, no. As soon as the meeting has been started.
Admitting,
yeah, I made Sylvia, you, okay. Uma Chitra, okay. Vahini, and yes. Madam, everyone has hosts and co-hosts.
Okay. Please continue.
Yeah, Dr. Right, Lakshmi yeah. also needs to be made co-host, Sylvia, so that he can also okay. share the slides. Yeah. I'll be stepping out because I have to join a webinar. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Okay, sir.
Yeah, I'm getting ready. We actually have another
yes.
webinar happening
here. Yes, Dr. Uma. Sir. Yes, let madam continue her talk.
Yes, I don't see her on this too.
What happened?
I don't see her on the right side, sir. Her otherwise, her name will appear on the right side and I can allow her to enter, but I don't see it.
Madam, you may be there. Link way in one, madam. Hello, Lakshmi Garu. Sir, Lakshmi Garu.
Mahesh sir.
Sir, under the screen, are they madam they disconnect?
Madam, they are they UPS Lena Tundi, PCK. UPS Lega Potta, current woman, a portal.
Be there current going the
current point is undergoing this.
Okay, UPS we are the country.
And in Ankuntana, UPS Lake of Inda is a exactly.
Chapan, sir, madam, Chapan's Lakshmi, sir. Chapan, sir, madam, position,
Chapan.
And Chapan, sir, position, Chapan.
Please put on.
My, you mean the madam link of any? అరే యూపీఎస్ ఉంటుంది కదా వచ్చింది మళ్ళీ మాకు కూడా పోయింది వచ్చింది వస్తుందా లాగిన్ కమ్మని
ఆ డైరెక్టర్ డాక్టర్ హేమలత మ్యామ్ విల్ బి జాయినింగ్ సూన్
Yes, yes, that woman.
Yes.
Madam is joining.
Yes.
ఉమా చిత్ర హలో డాక్టర్ ఉమా చిత్ర
ఆర్
యు దేర్
అచ్చా
మరి ఇఫ్ మేడం ఇస్ మేడం కెన్ కంటిన్యూ ఆఫ్టర్ వర్డ్ షెల్ ఐ కంటిన్యూ ఆస్క్ మహేష్ సార్
Sir, Dr. Lakshmaya wants to start his talk. Is it possible? Dr. Maheshwar? Sir, do you want to start then?
Oh. Yes, everyone. So I pardon me for this technical glitches, power failure, as well as internet connection, disruption in internet connection. Some major power problem or technical problem seems to be occurred at the director's office. Now, meanwhile, I request Dr. Lakshmaya to start his presentation, and I invite Dr. Uma.
Sir, can we just introduce you, sir? I now call upon Dr. Swati. Okay, sir. But before that, shall I ask Swati to? Swati has to introduce you, sir.
Yeah, that's okay. But
okay. Yes, I will make you the co-host. Swati, I now request Dr. Swati Chitra to introduce Dr. Lakshmaya.
A very good morning to all. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce the second speaker of today's webinar, Dr. Lakshmaya sir. Dr. Lakshmaya sir has been working since more than 28 years in ICMR National Institute of Nutrition Hyderabad in various positions. Currently, sir is scientist G and heading the Division of Public Health and Nutrition. He has carried out more than 50 large-scale epidemiological studies, translational research from impact evaluations, and randomized clinical trials in the field of nutrition and health. He has published more than 150 papers, both in national as well as international peer-reviewed journals like The Lancet Global Health, Nature, Obesity Research, etc. He is also a recipient of several awards and honors. To name a few, he's a recipient of International Union of Nutritional Sciences USA, International Training and Travel Fellowship Award 2006, INF USA Fellowship Award 2007, CRAC International Travel Grants Award, International Health Professional of the Year 2010, by Research and Advisory Board, Cambridge University UK, Postdoctoral Training Award from Bristol University and London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine 2012. He is presently a honorary senior research fellow in Faculty of Medicine, Imperial College, London, UK. Today, sir will be communicating to us on feeding smart, right from start, relevance, and reality. Over to you, sir.
Sir, Swati, I request you to kindly make Dr. Lakshmaya the host now. I'm not able to do it from my end.
Even host is, the permission is not given to me now. I'm Swati. Either a co-host or host.
Yeah, the same thing has happened to me. I'm not able to.
It's probably only Maheshwar sir can do it now. Hey, because sir is a host.
Dr. Maheshwar, I request you to kindly make Dr. Lakshmaya the host now.
Maheshwar.
Sir, Dr. Maheshwar, are you there?
Yes, Dr. Uma.
Are you have to make me co-host.
How to make the co-host disappear?
You just have to scroll or you have to click on participants first. And when you click on participants, you'll get a sidebar on the right side.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, more. You can click more.
And then you click on Dr. Lakshmaya's name. Dr. A. Lakshmaya. And when you click on his name.
More, yes.
Make host anointed, sir. Our options.
Yes, yes. I made.
Okay.
I made Lakshmaya as a host.
Not yet coming now. Can ask somebody technical.
Yes, sir. Lakshmaya, please proceed, sir.
Now it has come. Yes, My slides are visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Your slides are
very
visible.
Good morning and thank you everyone and especially Swati for your good words. And I'm also thank you Dr. Maheshwar for giving this opportunity and organizing a best webinar in a good theme. And unfortunately, so we could not hear from Dr. Hemalata because of some technical problems. So however, I will try to cover some of the things, but okay. So briefly, I can present on this in a half an hour, almost 30 minutes. And then we will, this session is open for question answers. So as you are all aware that the appropriate optimal nutrition is a fundamental pillar of human life and proper health development across the entire lifespan. So from the earliest stages of fetal development, at birth, infancy, childhood, adolescence, adulthood, and old age. So entire lifespan, the nutrition plays a greater role for all activities. So therefore, healthy diet and balanced nutrition are essential for survival, physical growth, mental development, performance, productivity, health and well-being. And as you know, the burden of nutrition burden globally, so 2 billion people are suffering from micronutrient malnutrition and 155 million children are stunted. And here the pathetic situation is almost one third of the stunted children is contributing India alone for global burden. So that we have to focus more on this. And 52 million children are wasted and 2 billion adults are either overweight or obese and 41 million children are overweight. 88% of countries face serious burden of either 2 or 3 forms of above malnutrition. So the SDGs present an unprecedented opportunity for universal and integrated change. So we have some SDG goals and according to the goals, we have to work together every country. So if you see what are the problems in India, the national nutrition challenges, we are facing triple burden of disease, that is protein energy malnutrition, micronutrient malnutrition, then diet related non-communicable diseases. Now we are living on epidemic of these non-communicable diseases, even though the undernutrition and micronutrient deficiencies are coming down, but the increasing in non-communicable diseases. So the nutritional deficiencies leads to iron deficiency anemia, folic acid deficiency leads to then vitamin E deficiency, so then iodine deficiency and zinc deficiency. So this neural tube, folic acid deficiency create neural tube defects. And B12 deficiency is also very high. And recently we have carried out this mapping of B12 deficiency 12 states in 9 states and almost on average 25% of B12 deficiency we observe in all the age groups like adolescents, adults and the old age population. So the key issues in childhood undernutrition in India is already said that the wasted and stunted is very high. And this is as per 2015 and 16, but in recent figures by CNNS, Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey reveals some significant reduction in these figures. And so those were, you can see initiation of these are the CNNS studies and NAN also part of this study. So initiation of breastfeeding, 57% of children 0 to 24 months were breastfed within 1 hour of birth. Exclusive breastfeeding, 58% of infants under age 6 months were exclusively breastfed and continued breastfeeding at 1 year. And 83% of children age 12 to 15 months continued breastfeeding at 1 year, above the age of 1 year. Complementary feeding, timely complementary feeding was initiated only around 50% only, and 42% of children 6 to 6 months were minimum number of times per day for their age, the minimum dietary diversity. So the food consumption among the school age children, I'm not skipping here, we are focusing only early childhood. And so the 35% of under 5 year were stunted. So that's what the reduction, there was a observation of significant reduction in stunted, and 17% were wasted, and 33% were underweight, and 11% were acutely malnourished, so as per different criteria. So the another 41% of preschoolers, 24% of school age, and 28% of adolescent were anemic. This is also very high. So stunting and severe wasting, intrauterine growth retardation together were responsible for 2.2 million deaths and 21% of disability adjusted life years for under 5 year children. So maternal undernutrition, low birth weight, and suboptimal infant and young child feeding practices, lack of risk for the personal hygiene, environmental sanitation, recurrent infections, infestations, and a host of socioeconomic demographic factors largely contributable to high undernutrition. So these are the factors we have to work together to reduce the malnutrition among children. So suboptimal breastfeeding was estimated to be responsible for 1 to 4 million child deaths and 44 million dallies a year. So the evidence showed that 10 to 15% of under 5 year deaths in resource poor countries could be prevented by achieving 90% exclusive breastfeeding alone, and 22% of neonatal deaths could be prevented if breastfeeding is initiated in less than 1 hour of birth. It is a very cost effective measure, and it involves no money, just initiation of breastfeeding in 1 hour. And stunting majorly explained by poor nutritional intake. So this is what we are focusing today. So the nutrition plays a greater role, and other associated factors also could play a major role. That is parental height and parental BMI, the maternal nutrition, and low birth weight, and intrauterine growth, and poor socioeconomic background, infectious diseases, failure of vaccine sometimes, and even low coverage of vaccine, and inadequate birth spacing, and food insecurity, and intestinal parasitic infection. And so to cover the intestinal parasitic infection, we have the program in India, biannual dose of intestinal parasites. And the studies have also shown that appropriate complementary feeding during the critical window will reduce undernutrition, childhood illness, and mortality, especially in the resource poor settings. So first hour initiation cuts, as already said, 22% of all days, and initiation of breastfeeding, you can see 30% to 100%. If we enhance initiation of breastfeeding within 1 hour, we can reduce the mortality 100%, whatever the contribution is from this. And neonatal deaths in 4 million, so we could reduce 1 million. This is published in India Pediatrics long back. So the risk of neonatal mortality according to time of initiation of breastfeeding, why I'm saying is what, so the importance of breastfeeding within 1 hour, you can say within 1 hour only 0.7 risk ratio, and from 1 hour to, if it is delayed to more than 1 hour, it is 1.2 risk ratio. And day two, if you initiate the breastfeeding, it is the risk of 2.5, and then day three it is 2.6 ratio. And after 3 days, if you anyone initiate the breastfeeding, the risk of developing death is 4 times higher than compared to within 1 hour. So the recent evidence reveals that undernutrition has been responsible directly or indirectly for 53% of 10.9 million deaths among children under 5 years of annually. And over 2/3 of these deaths are often associated with inappropriate feeding practices occur during the first year of life. Only about half of the infants would worldwide are exclusively breastfed during the first 6 months of life, and complementary feeding begins either too early in urban areas or too late in rural areas with foods which are often nutritionally inadequate and unsafe. This is the major problem we have to focus on this occasion. So especially in urban area, the urban mothers are very enthusiastic, and they think that their breast milk may not be sufficient. They introduce complementary foods before 6 months. And here rural mothers are very optimistic. They think that their breast milk is sufficient even after up to 1 year. So that is the behavioral understanding, the behavioral change is needed here. And the causes of death among under 5 years children in developing countries, we already discussed about directly, indirectly, malnutrition is contributing more than half of the child deaths. And this is also very important, the evidence for the fetal and infant origins of adult chronic diseases. If any child is suffered intrauterine growth retardation, so the child become born, the child become adults, the early onset of chronic diseases also, that David Barker, he hypothesized from a very the cohort study. From the cohort study, they are following more than 60 years now. So the relevance of smart and timely and optimal feeding, if you see, examine the why smart feeding is important. So malnutrition increased by first year, and at birth it was low. So virtually it is, at birth it is very, very low, but after 12 months of age, it is increasing, and we'll discuss further on that. And virtually irreversible after 1 year onwards only. So if the malnutrition continues beyond 1 year and 2 years, we cannot reverse some of the damages due to undernutrition. So 85% of child's core brain structure is formed by 2 to 3 years only, and undernutrition impairs cognition. Is all aware of that. These are not a new thing, and everybody aware. This impairs the cognitive development and intelligence and memory and the strength of the child and energy of the child and productivity, at last to protect their nation. So if the people become undernourished during childhood, during adolescence, during adulthood, ultimately the productivity loss of a nation. So that will lead to, that's why even WHO, World Bank, and IMF, these all the big finance units, they said that the nutrition is center for any country development. So that is the importance of the nutrition. So just we discussed undernutrition trend by age 6 months to 18 months. It is very visible. You can see at the birth, the prevalence of undernutrition is less. At the 18 months, it is the maximum, but it occurs growing 12 months significantly, and it is continued up to 5 years. So the 20% due to small size at birth, the undernutrition, and another 25% due to diarrhea and other infections, and the rest 55% due to suboptimal feeding. So more than half could be because of just suboptimal feeding and suboptimal nutrition only. And this slide also very important. You can see the what is the contribution of diarrhea and suboptimal feeding and the undernourishment, and at the same time, where the diarrhea is occur, where are the suboptimal feeding, and the 7 months to 12 months, so, and after 12 months, the undernutrition is increasing. And this is the scope of intervention is very dedicated interventions is required. And this slide also very important, and first 2 years of life are the key important, because here, but ICDS service in this period has a low focus because it is the design flow. So we are focusing most of the children, 3 to 6 years children only attend the Anganwadi center. The care is taken, the hot cooked food is given, but less than 3 years children, they are in the house, and if the mother goes to the work, so no one take care of this crucial period. So that is the importance of this period. And you can see the undernutrition occurs in the first and the second year, and period of rapid brain growth and maturation 80% by 2 years. This is the brain development. And linear growth failure in this period is associated with the adult short structure and less cooling also there. The effects of this undernutrition, short stature is already, several publications are available on this, and less cooling and less productivity and less offspring of birth weight in females. And another thing also, recently some journalists mentioned, the chances of marriages also very less. So those adults are short stature and undernourished. And this is during 2 to 3 years, how this synaptic system, nervous system will develop. You can see 36 weeks of gestation, So just 100 billion neurons at birth, and these neurons, the connectivity developed the newborn age at 3 months and 6 months, how it is connectivity is establishing in the neurons, neuron to neuron connectivity, synapses connectivity, and 2 years and 4 years and 6 years, almost complete development at 6 years will happen. That's why during this period is very, very nutrition plays a crucial role for optimal development of neuron system in our body. So this is poor diet can affect multiple generations, says expert. And this was I have published in very long back. It is 2014, and this was appeared in Indian Express. So impact of nutrition in early life, impact of nutrition in early life, and nutritious status of the mother and birth weight of the child and the adult body weight. So this is a consequence. So if birth weight is normal and the adult also normal, you can see here overnutrition and overweight, and then these are the obesity problems and undernutrition, underweight, and this chronic. Just now we discussed non-communicable disorder like diabetes. This is a symbol for diabetes. Glucose test is going on. And what is a smart feeding for the child? So this is the early initiation of breastfeeding and exclusive breastfeeding under 6 months, and continued breastfeeding 2 years, and introduction of solid, semi-solid, soft foods at 6 months, and minimum dietary diversity, minimum meal frequency, minimum acceptable diet, consumption of iron-rich and iron-fortified foods, and responsive fooding. So that's why today, and this year's the nutrition theme is the smart feeding at birth, and that should be continued. So the title is very appropriate in this junction because of this gaps in the nutrition. So infant and young child feeding, these are this already described: initial breastfeeding, exclusive breastfeeding, complementary feeding, timely introduction of complementary feeding, maintaining adequate diet and dietary diversity beyond 6 months, along with the continued breastfeeding. This is also very important. And you can see the breastfeeding with 1 hour birth reduces the risk of neonatal mortality. This is another study. They observed that 33% we can reduce the neonatal deaths, and exclusive breastfeeding can reduce 30% under 5 days. And breastfeeding has a tremendous impact on the cognitive development. And these everything we also everyone aware that because of last month also breastfeeding week, we have discussed all these issues and advantages of breastfeeding, and these are not new, but anyhow, we are just another time we have to just recall all the breast milk is the best natural food for the babies, clean, and it is hygienic. It protects the baby from certain infectious disease, makes the child more intelligent, available 24 hours a day, require no special preparation, nature's gift to the infant, and does not need to be purchased, and makes a special relationship, the bonding. So the bonding is also very important from mother and child. So the breastfeeding is not only important for young child survival, health, nutrition, development of the baby's trust and sense of security, but also enhances brain development and learning readiness. So these are very, very important, and various research studies have brought out the beneficial effects of exclusive breastfeeding for the 6 months. And the deficit in nutrition inputs first 6 months, that's what we already described, this one, exclusive breastfeeding is slowly reducing even before 6 months. Actually, this curve should be straight like this up to 6 months, and we are losing this portion of mothers. This proportion of mothers we are losing, they are not following exclusive breastfeeding. Lot of other foods and fluids displace breast milk here. Deficits in nutrition in inputs 7 to 12 months. This is also very important because the introduction of foods, also lot of other foods and fluids displace the breast milk, and breast milk should be continued up to 1 year, but that is not happening, and complementary feeding also should be continued. So what is the reality in nutrition? What is the reality? So we have we have targets for smart feeding, and what is the reality and nutrition situation in children. So the indicators, we already said that the NFHS-4 and NFHS-3 and 4 saying that the children under age of 3 years breastfed within 1 hour is only even less than 50%. And the recent NFHS-5 showing that around 50%, but the full data is not available for all state data is available. And children under age 6, exclusive breastfeed is only 55%. Some of the states showing is 65% to 70%. And children age 6 to 8 months receiving solid or semi-solid food or breast milk is around 50% only. There is no improvement over a period of time also. So breastfeeding children 6 to 23 months receiving an adequate diet is only, you can see, this is a drastic gap. Only 9% of children are getting only adequate diet, and the rest of the almost 91% children are not getting adequate diet. So that's what we have to focus on now. And even the NNMB, National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau, NIN, carried out diet surveys in rural areas and diet surveys in urban areas. And the consumption of dietary consumption among these young children, you can see. So almost except roots and tubers, all foodstuffs are lacking deficit if you compare to the 100% RDA. You can see. So if you compare 100% of RDA, all foods especially, so milk and products is very, very low, and green leafy vegetables are very, very low, and pulse and legumes also low, and only cereals and millets, then roots and tubers, some extent other vegetables they are consuming. So that's why the dietary diversity is very, very low among the children. If you see the nutrient gap also very high, calcium is grossly deficient, vitamin E is grossly deficient, and iron also some extent is deficient, riboflavin also deficient, vitamin C, because the green leafy vegetable intake is very, very low, even vitamin C deficiency also very low. So the mean intake of foods among rural women, if you see the pregnant women, lactating women, so the any nutrition status of the early childhood all depends on maternal nutrition. So maternal nutrition, if you see pregnant women and lactating women, so the recommended diet and what they are exactly eating. Actually, pregnant women and lactating women require an additional amount of these foods. But they are not crossing, not beyond the NPNL women, non-pregnant and non-lactating women. So we have to focus here. And in this context, we have also organized an international conference on the 1,000 days of life. 1,000 days of life, not only required, and we need even before and after also. Before 1,000 days means the maternal nutrition status. We have to screen the maternal nutrition status. Those who are potential mothers after marriage, we have to enroll all the married couples or married women. Those women are ready for going for pregnancy. We have to screen and correct the deficiencies of different micronutrients. So then only we can achieve the optimal healthy child and normal birth weight children. So this is average nutrient for rural women, lactating, pregnant women. Here also the pregnant and the NPN and lactating women, you can see. So some of the micronutrients are grossly deficient. Right? So you take calcium, iron, vitamin A, and riboflavin. So way forward, what we have to do? So this is another problem is, you can see here. Yes. So that we have to focus majorly on infant and young child feeding from. So you can see that the time. So we have to timely, we have to introduce, and the quality, quantity of this feeding is very important. So introduction of solid and semi-solid soft foods, preparation of infant, the proportion of infants 6 to 8 months of age who received solid, semi-solid and soft foods. And these are what is the minimum we have to follow, all these definitions. And accordingly, we have to feed the child and complementary foods based on the age of the infant. So the what I told is the frequency, then the quantity, quality of foods is very, very important while feeding. The seventh month, how to feed 2 to 3 feeds per day, less frequent breastfeeds. And then 2 to 3 tablespoons, so 1/4 of cups, we have to average amount of each feed and meal and consistent texture. And it is a different foods and semi-solids and thick porridge. And 8 to 9 months, 4 to 5 feeds per day. And the mothers, that's especially in Bulgaria, mothers think that we eat 3 times, even children also eat 3 times, but that is not correct. Because their gut is very small, and that also we are going to discuss. And so these are the measures, these are the applicable things we have to do. And 3 meals and 3 snacks plus breastfeeds. So 10 to 12 months of child. If you follow these prescriptions for the, especially under 1 year of the child, so the child would grow properly. So opportunity in child health program, we have several national nutrition programs, national nutrition sensitive programs, especially ITDS, and in adult school age, in school age and adolescent children, MDM is also there, and IFA tablet, iron fortified syrups also available. So here, all these programs, we have to converge these programs and work towards this thing. And so the malnutrition accelerate here, that we already discussed, it is 6 months onwards only, it is increasing the undernutrition. The role of ICDS is very, very important here. The ICDS focus should be less than 3 years of the children. Otherwise, it is very difficult to solve this program. Yeah, this is also, because the children, the mothers, the parents, the mothers, they don't know how to feed the children. That is, the smart feeding is required. Smart feeding means they should know the how much the child can eat. So day one, the size of the stomach is only size of the cherry. So only 5 to 7 ml of 1 to 2 teaspoons only the capacity. And the day two, the size of your walnut stomach. So this knowledge we have to give to the mother. So how much they can feed and what is the concentration they should feed. And 1 week only the size of an apricot. So this is the size of the child gut. So then the size of a large egg after 1 month. So that little improvement is there. And so depending upon the age, the stomach also increases and the requirement also increases. The frequency also increases. So we have to follow all these the guidelines to working mothers. Ensure that child is comfortable with family members. Suppose the mother is leaving the child with the other family members. So the mother ensure that the child is comfortable with family members. And train caregiver 10 to 15 days before you start work and before leaving the house, you have to train the other people who are taking care of the child. And keep expressed breast milk at home if possible, and that breast milk only given to the child by caregivers. And start complementary feeds above 6 months and breastfeed before work and at night. So before work also, she should give breast milk sufficiently, and after coming back also she can give breast milk. So the time constraints of the mother, some of the mothers it is very helpless, and because of mother is a multitasker. So as you all aware that mother is a multitasker in everywhere, not only in rural area, even in urban area also, mother is a multitasker. So the time constraint is the mother. Ready to eat food and snacks perceived as a solution to time constraint. But this is wrong. So that's what the inappropriate feeding is given. And penetration of ready to eat market foods. So this is also very important because nowadays, a lot of junk food is available with a low price and readily available, accessible, and the money is not important nowadays. So this is the replacement of home food is taking place. This we have to stop. Until this we stop, the health of the child will not improve. And another importance is the tasty. Whatever ready-to-eat foods are tasty, accessible, and universal reach, then colorful variety attract affordable. All these things also making habituated with the consuming ready to eat goods, not only children, even adults also. So that will lead to childhood obesity. So the childhood obesity is also, several studies are published and even I have presented several times. If the childhood obesity ignores at childhood stage, so the likelihood of chances is 77% of the childhood obesity people, the obesity is carried over during adulthood also. So that is the danger of childhood obesity. So mother's absolute affection is required. The Ministry of Health and Family Strategies for Promotion of IVCF is given guidelines, and village and health nutrition days, they are conducting in every village, every month. During these days, we have to create awareness on IVCF under NHM also they are creating. And nutrition rehabilitation centers, lot of NRCs also there. The screening should be done for the children, those who are undernourished, severely undernourished, they should be sent to the NRCs. And facilitating IMS Act, this is also very important, IMS Act, we have to strictly implement. No formula milk is allowed until unless if the lactation failure is there. So effect of maternal stress, this also recently found that, observed that lack of maternal stress also leading to preterm delivery 25% to 60%, then low birth weight, then developmental delays in low birth weight. So these are all we can avoid. We can also maternal stress, we have to reduce the maternal stress. And for how to reduce maternal stress also, there is another lecture. So that will take a lot of time. I cannot deal now. So the take-home message, what we have to do, critical periods in utero, during utero also, it is a critical period. That's why the potential mothers, we have to take care. And in during birth also, we have to take care. And after birth, we have to take care of nutrition, proper care, and responsive care, responsive feeding. And 2 to 3 years, a balanced diet, we have to feed. And balanced diet includes, so frequency, as I already said, frequency, quality, quantity, all three should be there. And also it should be acceptable culturally. The food should be acceptable culturally. And womb is highly stimulating environment, physical, mental, emotional development, and peaceful environment, nutrition, and soothing music, mental and spiritual practices also can be done. It should be done, actually. It should be done during pregnancy. And during pregnancy, during the after birth, emotional stability, positive thoughts also very important. Parents' mindset shapes the entire future of the child, because we have also seen in Mahabharata. So these stories also there, Abhimanyu, he learned from inside, from when he was inside the womb. So the Balamrutam, we have also prepared a Balamrutam NIN, and that the product one, product two, now it is available. It is a fortified with 9 micronutrients. Balamrutam is being supplied through state government in 2 states, and this should be utilized properly. And this will also cover or combat all micronutrient deficiencies. Thank you, Maheshwar, and especially our director giving this opportunity to speak on this occasion.
So thank you, Dr. Lakshmi sir, thank you. Yeah, very much on my own behalf and on behalf of Extension and Training Division. And here I have an announcement, the pleasant announcement. As our director madam couldn't present her presentation today due to technical problems, she asked me to convey that she's going to present the same talk on the same topic on 23rd, that is day after tomorrow, and we'll shortly share the link for that webinar. Hence, please join on 23rd for that webinar and to listen to our director madam on the same topic. Now, I request Dr. Uma Chitra to go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for that announcement. And I request everyone who's joined today to again join on the 23rd. And thank you so much, Dr. Lakshmaya, for your exhaustive presentation, which highlighted the importance of nutrition, both in utero and also during the first 2 years of life. I now request Dr. Swati Chitra to kindly present a vote of thanks. Swati, Are you there, Swati?
Yes, ma'am, I'm there. Are we open for any questions, ma'am? Or
no one has asked any questions in the chat box.
Sure. Okay. So, I would like to express my gratitude to all the esteemed delegates of the webinar for their presence and contribution to make this webinar a great success. However, we could not have our first speaker, Dr. Hemlata Madam. And I extend my gratitude to still both our speakers, Director Madam and Dr. Lakshmaya Sir, for taking out their time in their busy schedule and giving their valuable deliberations. A special thanks to Dr. Maheshwar Sir, HOD ED Division, and Dr. Uma Chitra Ma'am for the moderation of this webinar. And I extend my thanks to all the organizers of this webinar. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
So once again, on my behalf, thank you each and every one of you who have participated in this seminar. Thank you. Now we conclude this meeting.